So you like the idea of silver swords, huh? Wanna know how practical that would be? Well, let's talk about it, ya fancy nerd. So, silver weapons are pretty common in a variety of fantasy settings. It's no longer just limited to the silver bullet for the werewolf. The most iconic would be the silver swords in the Witcher series. The swords there, at least according to the Witcher Wikia, are not actually made of pure silver, but it's a steel blade that has been silver plated to get that effect. More about that later. So, silver, of course, has fascinated humans throughout history, just like any precious metals, just like gold and a variety of other, you know, shiny gems. It's always, you know, we're kind of crows. We like shiny things. And silver is also sometimes associated with the moon. Well, makes sense. Silver reflects very well, so does the moon. And there is generally a tendency for silver to be associated with purity. Since it is a precious metal, it doesn't corrode the way iron does. Purity is often taken as something that opposes evil beings or chaos or darkness. Now, technically, if purity is what you're after, then gold would be better because it's the least reactive metal. It doesn't rust at all. Pure gold doesn't tarnish. But there's something about silver that seems to suggest purity to the human mind. And so there's also, as a side note, mirrors used to have a silver backing, and that's where the vampire myth comes from, that they don't show up in a mirror because it's believed that because they're unholy, the silver just wouldn't reflect their image. Another version is that mirrors reflect part of your soul, and vampires have no soul. Aside from its resistance to corrosion, you can also point to another property that fits with this purity idea, namely that silver has antibacterial properties, or at least nanoparticles of silver. Silver in its solid metal form doesn't do that, but a silver nitrate solution, for example, kills off bacteria. Silver also blackens from contact with sulfur. And, you know, sulfur is obviously very unpleasant. It's often associated with the devil or demons in general. And, you know, it's also an indicator of rot. And so this reaction of silver to it makes it seem kind of like it shows you if there's corruption or, you know, rot and evil. So when it comes to these mystical effects of silver, the question is, how pure exactly does it have to be? For example, if you look at sterling silver, which jewelry is commonly made of, it's 92.5% silver and 7.5% copper. Is that enough? Arguably, that's not pure because another metal is present. Anyway, let's talk about how feasible silver swords would be, or not. Now, this is the point in the video where I'm gonna come at you with a bunch of numbers, so you might wanna get something to bite on. I'll start out with the Mohs scale. Now, just a few words about it. Now, this is used for minerals, but has also been applied to metals. And so this is just an arbitrary comparative scale that just goes by which material scratches which other material. If it's harder, it scratches the softer thing. So on the Mohs scale, gold and silver are 2.5 to 3, copper and bronze are 3, which is a little weird because bronze as an alloy of copper is harder than copper. Steel 4 to 4.5, iron 4.5, and hardened steel would be 7 to 8. This scale isn't terribly useful for this, because, as said, copper and bronze being the same and silver almost the same, if you go by this, then silver is not that bad. But we'll get to the Vickers scale now. You find different quotes for different metals. I'll just show you what I found after digging around for I don't know how long. So, according to what I found, pure silver would be 30 HV on the Vickers scale. Cast sterling silver would be 55 to 80. If you work harden, in other words, hammer the sterling silver, you can get up to 140 to 180 HV. Copper would be 40 HP. Again, I found different numbers here. Bronze, so that's copper alloyed with 10% tin, would be 80 to 90 and can be hammered to bring it up to around 250. So bronze clearly is better than silver. I mean, pure silver, forget about it. It's way too soft, 30 compared to hardened bronze, 250. So the sterling silver, on the other hand, you can get up to apparently 180. Bronze, 250. It's not super terribly far apart. And it gets interesting when you look at historical swords. It's quite a large variety. You can have anything from astonishingly soft to so hard that you have to worry about it being too brittle and breaking. So, for example, in some 11th to 12th century swords, the lowest hardness that was found was around 100 HV on the Vickers scale. Modern reproduction swords are usually between 500 and 550. You can control very well nowadays how to temper it precisely to a specific hardness. Now, if you look at the highest hardness found in historical swords, there are a few examples from the 10th as well as the 15th and 16th century that go up to 650. So that's harder than modern reproductions. So yeah, from 100 to 650, that is quite a large range. It's not just about hardness, there are many other factors that determine the quality of a sword, like, you know, strength, toughness, wear resistance, etc. If you look at tensile strength and yield strength for fine silver, so it's pure silver, the tensile strength is 125 megapascals. For sterling silver, it's 207, and iron is between 414 and 1380. So again, quite a large variety depending on the quality of the iron, what you do with it, if it's hardened or not. The yield strength of fine silver is 54 MPa, for sterling silver 124 MPa, and for iron between 275 and 620. So clearly silver is pretty soft and not very strong, especially pure silver. Sterling silver you can do a lot more with because you can harden it. In history, cutlery and pocket knives have been made with silver blades, and that could either be a blade made entirely of sterling silver or a steel blade that was silver plated. And that was good for cutting fruit because it wouldn't stain as easily. If you think about bronze swords, they are limited in what you can do with them compared to iron and steel. Bronze is not as bad as some people seem to think, but of course it's worse than hardened iron and especially steel. And generally you have relatively short blades. So as far as swords are concerned, this is about as long as it gets, maybe a little longer, but the limitations of this material make it so that you can't make an extremely long sword. So if you wanted to make an actual long sword, you know, like you see in The Witcher, out of, you know, nothing but sterling silver, I don't think that would work so well. The material will probably not support that kind of size. But something smaller, like a dagger or a short sword, might be viable. How does all this matter? Well, it determines how well a blade made of this or that material would perform, how easily the material would deform or break, how keen of an edge it would take, you know, how easily it would retain the edge, you know, how durable the edge would be. There are a lot of materials that you can actually put a very fine edge on, but they just wouldn't be durable. You have to keep in mind how thin the edge of a sword is, at least if you want it to cut well. So you've got this thin, ideally hardened waver of metal, and if it's too soft, then it will just bend as you try to cut something and it won't bite anymore. So then you would have to hone that again, straighten out the edge, or the edge may simply get crushed or otherwise deform, and you get a few cuts out of it, and that's it if the material is too soft. Also determines, of course, how easily the overall blade bends or otherwise gets damaged. All right, so how could we work with this? Again, it depends on how pure the silver has to be. If it has to be actually pure silver, now we're in trouble, because again, that's very, very soft. It depends a little bit on exactly how it works in this fantasy scenario. How, like, does the silver cut or burn even through supernatural monster hide where steel would just not bite into it because it's that tough? Is there something magical about the silver that just goes into monster flesh like butter? Or does it prevent healing? That's another common trope, where a steel sword will cause a wound on a monster, but it will close back up almost immediately because it has a healing factor, and then the silver disables that healing. So if you need really pure silver, you could probably get away with a silver axe or mace or hammer, for example. There are finds of historical copper mace heads, and copper is harder than silver, but it's not dramatically different, unless it's hardened copper. So that could actually work, because that way you have enough material that, you know, it won't just collapse on impact like a sharp edge would. So with an axe, you could possibly get away with something that is, you know, a fairly thick wedge. Copper axe blades like this are viable. You just can't sharpen them quite as well as iron or steel. So they have to be a little thicker. Won't cut quite as well, but would still do damage, obviously. And if you have a mace or a hammer mounted on a wooden handle, even if it deforms on impact, it's not going to be that big of a deal, because you still have a massive chunk of metal to hit the monsters with. So that would be viable. What I could also imagine would be some kind of silver spike. So just like some daggers in history had either a round or triangular or square cross section that were just for thrusting, you could potentially do this with silver as well. If it's like, if the point is thick enough, might work even with pure silver, maybe. I almost forgot to mention silver arrowheads or crossbow bolts should also be viable. Copper works well enough for that, and even if they deform on impact, they should still be effective enough. So let's get back to The Witcher. Those swords, as said, are a steel blade with silver plating. Would that be viable? Yes. Yes, it would. You could do that. The drawback of that would be that it would be high maintenance. So you would have to regularly restore the silver plating on the blade, including after each sharpening. Because if you sharpen it, you remove material. So unless you have a very thick silver plating, you probably grind it off as soon as you sharpen it. So after sharpening, you would have to silver plate it again. And it's not something you could just do at a camp. So you'd have to go to a blacksmith every time to have that maintained and restored. What I find interesting is that in the Witcher series, silver blades are less effective against humans. And that would make perfect sense if it was a solid silver blade. If it's soft silver, then yeah, as soon as you strike somebody, as soon as you strike armor, or even just a body, bone, things like that, the edge would deform immediately and it would be unusable after a couple of swings. It would probably also bend very quickly, and it wouldn't be effective at all. Even against a naked person, you probably wouldn't get very far. However, if the Witcher Wikia is correct on this, and it is actually in-game lore that the swords are steel with silver plating, then there is really no reason why they would be less effective against human enemies. I mean, you would tear up the silver plating pretty quickly, especially if you have to parry or you hit armor, etc. You would really wreck the silver plating. But you still have the sharp steel blade underneath, so it should still be effective. But, you know, for gameplay purposes, of course, it makes sense. Okay, so I've got three more ideas for this. One would be a chisel grind on this blade. So if you imagine, this side is the steel. You grind just the one side, so you get a chisel edge, and then you plate this side with silver. You still got the steel forming the edge, and then the other surface is silver. Now, the question is, does the very edge itself have to be silver? Now, this would only work if the silver prevents the healing. So the steel can cut in, open up the wound, and the contact with the silver prevents the healing. Or you could have a thrusting blade with a fuller that's filled with silver. So the steel point enters, and then as soon as that happens, the silver makes contact with the inside of the monster. That sounds great. And, you know, has whatever effect, prevents healing or does more damage etc. And in that sense, there are some historical blades that would actually fulfill the same purpose. There are, you know, blades with silver inlays. So you've got engravings, essentially, that are filled with silver. And this was, of course, done just for decorative purposes, to make the weapon finer and suited for a noble owner, and just to look nice. But that could work, at least to prevent the healing, because you still have that silver there that makes contact with the flesh of the monster. So something like this could actually work as a monster slayer. Alright, so I've saved the craziest idea for last. Basically, silver venom. So either you take ground silver dust and mix it into some kind of sticky substance, or you have some sort of fairly thick silver solution and you fill a scabbard with it. So just, you have a regular steel sword and have that stuff in your scabbard, and every time you sheathe it and unsheathe it, you'll have like a layer of silver goop on there, essentially. Some kind of sticky stuff that covers the blade, and you would basically have silver venom, as said. So you would cut or stab the monster, and then you have this liquid silver inside the wound that burns away at it, or, you know, does whatever silver does, you know, cleanses the impure evil, things like that. Anyway, that's all I could think of on this topic. Hope you enjoyed it. Check out the links down below. If you liked the video, consider supporting the channel on Patreon. Or maybe you want to buy some razor blades. This also helps out the channel. Anyway, thanks for watching. Have a good one, folks.